Thank you, Catherine.
Ms. Wills.
I'm Chia Ziefler, and I have the utter pleasure of introducing the first session in today's conference. And I was fascinated by hearing Eleanor present to a meeting full of clinicians and providing some great insights into patient experience and patient perspectives in treatment of UTI. And I look forward very much to the talks in this session. I'm going to, which is entitled Bladder Health. And I'm going to read the bios of the speakers for today. Everyone's cringing as I suggest that. And I'd also like to invite people as they join. I think we're having increasing numbers of participants as time goes by. If you are comfortable, please do pop in the chat who you are, who's here in the meeting, and what your interests are, perhaps, or where you hail from, or area of expertise, so that we can gather some awareness of who's contributing. And if you do have questions as we go along as well, I'd really welcome you to put questions in the chat. I suggest that we give some time to each speaker to have a couple of questions after they've spoken, and then I'll have a look and see how much time we have at the end of this session to have a slightly more open discussion once everyone has spoken. And so I'm mindful that we're even a couple of minutes early starting this session. So I'll jump in and read some of the bios. We have Eleanor Kashouris first, who's Eleanor is a doctoral student in sociology here at the University of Sussex. And her work is entitled Marginalisation and the Microbe. And the project looks at patient experiences of hard to treat urinary tract infections or urinary symptoms, and recognising that responses to antimicrobial resistance have the potential to further entrench existing health inequalities. And the research explores how urinary tract infection appears in policy mobilisations on antimicrobial resistance, and with a particular attention to how a role for patients is imagined. And in the hopes that the work will draw attention to what issues just and effective responses to antimicrobial resistance. So what those issues might consider, what those responses might consider. And Eleanor is a member of the Advisory Committee on Antimicrobial Prescribing Resistance and Healthcare Associated Infection at the Department of Health. So it's a great pleasure to invite you.
Cool. So I'm getting I can just talk like this and everyone can hear me. Just talk at a normal volume. Okay, cool. Okay, so yes, I'm Eleanor Kashouris, and like she said, I've been working on my PhD on the Marginalisation and the Microbe project since 2019, and I will hand in my thesis in a couple of weeks' time, and it's an exploration of patient and public roles on community UTI and AMR. Then you can go to the next slide, please, Matt. So, writing the blurb for this panel, I wrote, "A panel on bladder health asks what patient expertise could mean in an era of emerging antimicrobial resistance and navigates doubt about how best to care for patients as UTI becomes a key target of policy mobilizations against AMR." So you can see that I'm using the language of patienthood here in this conference and in my thesis to talk about people who are involved in these issues surrounding bladder health, UTI and AMR because of their own health. But who are these people? Who is the invoked we working with doubt about how best to care for them? Those of you who are clinically trained will also inevitably have experience of seeking care in a patient role. And during this research, which I began because of my own experiences with UTI, I have been very careful about the moments when I've allowed my own patienthood to come through. In this paper, I'm going to offer some reflections on the hard work involved in naming patients, conceptualizing patienthood, and defining a patient role in clinical care and public engagement on AMR. And the next slide, please, Matt, thank you. And the theoretical work that I'm going to use is Jeanette Pohl's work on patient knowledge as a knowing in action, and Yasmin Gunaratnam's concept of a doubled practice, which is used to begin conversations and start research, but always showing the limitations and inadequacies. And the next slide, please. And the work that this is based on is the work I did for my thesis, which is 29 semi-structured interviews with premenopausal non-pregnant people treated under clinical guidelines written for women. These were online interviews with people located across the UK, and they were object interviews supported by photographs, which I'm aware doesn't mean much just saying that, but I'm going to explain that later. Just to note that I recruited people from symptoms rather than from UTI. So I asked to speak to people with experience of urinary symptoms. And I also did supplementary interviews with 11 clinicians and 11 other stakeholders. Great, thanks. So recently I had the opportunity to participate on a committee, a NICE committee for UTI diagnostics. And the public involvement advisor told me that although the PPI member would be able to take part in the more technical evidence discussion, the role demanded that they would really need to bring that patient perspective, putting together slides on what it is like to live with chronic UTI. And for me, this reflects a familiar division of labor in inviting patients to tell us how they feel about disease and leaving it to doctors to tell us about the matter of facts of disease. As Paul points out, this has the effect of romanticizing patient experience while at the same time downgrading it from knowledge. And this has the effect of demanding that non-sufferers respectfully listen to sufferers' incontestable experience while simultaneously separating that experience off from the realm of knowledge, which is left to healthcare practitioners. I turned down this opportunity, wanting to resist the role being offered to patients, but also avoiding embodying myself becoming the patient voice, as I also have this other role as a sociologist in training. And I think similar divisions are visible in AMR policy. Invited patient participation often looks like enrolling people as AMR survivors or AMR victims to tell about their scary experiences and how it made them feel. I think it's maybe a bit bizarre that these patient stories of times when antibiotics were desperately needed are often enrolled to encourage others who presumably might then recognize their own antibiotic use as inappropriate not to use antibiotics. Only healthcare practitioners are invited to make reflective decisions about when to use antibiotics and not. What this does, I argue, is maintain strict boundaries about who is ill and who is well, who is a doctor and who a patient, who is legitimately in need of antibiotics and who is not. These strict boundaries stop us from noticing the ways that we are all relationally invested in good care, including around antibiotics. But clearly, there are different roles here. You wouldn't be happy to have me be your doctor. I'm not clinically trained at all. So there are different roles here. There are issues of expertise and there are issues of care. So how could we conceptualize patienthood and the patient role? So a good starting point is that the idea of patienthood is tricky with UTI and urinary symptoms because of the way that UTI moves between the home and the clinic. In standard care pathways for suspected UTI in England, which you can see on the screen, this is the, what was Public Health England NICE guidance. People are encouraged to do self-care. If you can just click again, Matt. Yeah, people are encouraged to do self-care. And if you can click again, thanks. And antibiotics may or may not be prescribed immediately, even if diagnosed with a UTI. There's not a straightforward link between diagnosis and treatment. And that's dependent on, you can see in the bits I've pulled out there, it's dependent on things like symptom severity and if the patient is pregnant or not. So this way of encouraging self-care, caring for symptoms at home, either instead of consulting a healthcare practitioner or instead of taking antibiotics after having consulted, is seen as a key antimicrobial stewardship around community UTI. And if you look back at the older literature around UTI, which often doesn't even mention AMR at all, demedicalization of AMR, of UTI, sorry, actually emerged as a really important aim in policy work then. Some people living with urinary symptoms don't consult a healthcare practitioner at all. And if we go on to the next slide, Olivia, one of my participants, presents her own behaviour as exactly the kind of behaviour policymakers worry about. And in her own words, she said, "I slept with someone new, felt irritation. I kind of panic about these things as well. Like I'm a bit of a freak with things like that. So I always, like, as soon as I think there's something not right, I'll go down to the clinic. But yeah, I think I'd slept with someone new, just wasn't feeling right, and then went and got checked. And that time, I think it didn't end up being a UTI. It was completely fine, but I had similar symptoms to that before. So it was just irritation. I felt like I needed to go to the toilet loads, but actually didn't need to. And that's what I've experienced in the past as well. So there's been a few occasions like that. But yeah, in the past, not that particular time, but in the past, I've taken antibiotics to help clear it up. And I think before as well, I want to say that it went away on its own, but I'm not sure if that's just me remembering it incorrectly. Can we and should we think of these people as patients? I don't really have an answer one way or another, but I think one answer comes through in the way that people who don't consult were less likely to be captured in my sample, even though I did not recruit through the language of UTI. We can often perceive these people only through absence, and there might be reasons to avoid drawing people into an issue that they haven't made for themselves. Olivia clearly did consult, but note how she makes several references to the way in which she's unsure what happened last time. She doesn't quite remember. It's hard to tell her experiences in an interview setting where she has been asked directly about them. And I think this is because Olivia didn't continue to be a patient once she left the clinic. Her episode of care seeking ended. For many people, when you come into the clinic and are diagnosed with a UTI, even if you leave with antibiotics in hand, which is not the case for everyone diagnosed with a UTI, or maybe hopefully that's not the case for everyone diagnosed with a UTI, you go back into your life or the workplace and you won't become a UTI patient again until the next time you are diagnosed with a UTI. So maybe patienthood isn't helpful to conceptualize these experiences. There may be reasons not to medicalize this experience. Can you go to the next slide, Matt? Thank you. But elsewhere, there are people for whom episodes of care seeking don't end. Standard care for many of these people comes under the category of recurrent UTI. And guidance in England says that for these people, advice on behavioral and personal hygiene measures should be given. Vaginal estrogen, which is sort of described in the guidance as an off-label use and also should be reviewed within 12 months. This is less relevant to my sample because I was looking more at premenopausal experiences. And then antibiotic prophylaxis, either daily or on exposure to a trigger. And it does also note that if antibiotic prophylaxis is stopped, people should have rapid access to treatment if they have an acute UTI. So I think this, I don't know if you can pick it up from this, but the sort of slightly defeated tone of the guidance is, I'm sure, familiar to many of you who practice clinically and those of you with personal experience of hard to treat UTI, which of course aren't mutually exclusive things to be. Care runs out, of course, as it is generally accepted that prophylaxis is effective until stopped, and also that it certainly drives resistance. I think it's worth reading these extracts from people struggling to become patients in need of care at length. Can go to the next slide, Matt. Thank you. So Sophie says, the GP practice said that I needed to come in with a urine sample. Now I've had honestly probably 100 UTIs and it just seems ridiculous that they would want to dip my urine. You know, this is a nightmare for me. I've got a toddler at home who, it's as clear as day, it's a UTI. The urine's cloudy, it spasms, it's a UTI. I've got a toddler at home who's just developed a cough. I've got two toddlers at home, right? I don't have a job, okay, but it's difficult to go down and dip my urine. But they said, no, it's our policy. We will not prescribe antibiotics unless you come in to drop a sample off. So I go in to drop a sample off. I still don't hear anything. It's going on, and then finally it gets to the evening. And finally a nurse called me up, and you know, it's as if she's totally out of it. She said to me, well, your urine did have traces of leukocytes in, so I can't say for sure, but I think it's a UTI. And I just said, no, it's a UTI. And Mina says, I recognize straight away when I get any symptoms and stuff like that, but they don't really ask more questions than that. They just say, right, okay, I'll prescribe you this. And if you don't feel better in X amount of days, come back. So they've stopped taking pee samples and stuff like that, or any further testing, any blood testing, or whatever they want to get to the bottom of it. It's just firefighting. So as soon as I feel the symptoms coming on, I just phone up and they give me a prescription and that's it. There are many different ways to read these stories. It is striking that they are so opposite. Where Mina describes being dismissed by an antibiotic prescription, Sophie describes barriers to accessing an antibiotic prescription. I think it's important to say that it is interesting, but it's not of interest to my argument, the way that comparing what is described happening in practice here to what's described in policy, i.e., for example, the way that no guidance in England suggests that an antibiotic prescription should be dependent on a positive urine dipstick. But what is of interest is there are many stories in my data of people trekking to urgent care in the middle of the night, waiting in pain until 9 a.m. to call the GP surgery, abandoning their work in the middle of the day. It is patienthood that allows us to recognize that these people need care, with or without antibiotics. Neither Mina nor Sophie is cared for. They need to be recognised as people who live long-term with painful bladders. And this is important because on the one hand, AMR interventions may promise to care for these patients by pointing out that antibiotics should not be a default response to a woman coming into contact with the clinic with urinary symptoms. On the other hand, AMR interventions which pull UTI out of other urinary symptoms and are orientated around the question of if antibiotics are needed or not, rather than the question of what to do about urinary symptoms. This threatens to make care for urinary symptoms even more constricted than it already is. What can be done for these patients? It's patienthood that keeps care central. Move to the next slide, please, Matt. Thanks. So I asked Ruth, a participant in the role of patient, what good care would look like. And she said, a doctor can speak with a person and discuss it with them. And that's necessary. That's part of being a doctor. You have to discuss with the patient. So then the doctor and the patient should decide and have a plan in place so you don't have to beg. You don't have to call on a Saturday night. A plan should be in place if somebody has a chronic condition. If you have a chronic condition, it's not something new that you're going to figure out. You should have a plan in place when these symptoms happen. This should be offered for me, that I get urine testing and I can take an antibiotic, or I should be on Hyprex and let me be on it long term, you know? So what Ruth describes is that to be cared for, the doctor needs to recognize you as a patient in need of care rather than someone coming into the clinic with a UTI. This is really important, and I would argue that the current clinical classifications of UTI versus recurrent UTI do not work hard enough to capture the patienthood of people who care for their bladders on a daily basis, often with symptoms that flare up into huge crises, coming into contact with the clinic only, as the guidance says, when an acute UTI can be diagnosed to be prescribed antibiotics. Note how Ruth touches on chronicity as a useful concept. But the patient needs to participate in this too, if we're thinking about a role for patients. Can you go to the next slide, please, Matt? Going back to Sophie, she is clear that what she wants is to be prescribed antibiotics. And this is because it is only antibiotics which have relieved her pain before. But note how Sophie says that this has happened hundreds of times before. And like Mina says, each time antibiotics are prescribed. For Sophie to be cared for, she would need not only to be recognized by her healthcare practitioner as in need of care, she would also need to be able to accept care, which goes beyond the antibiotics that mean you can get home to your toddlers quickly, even though you know you will be back next time for more antibiotics. To be cared for, you have to be able to recognize yourself as someone who is ill rather than someone who will be better if prescribed antibiotics. Sometimes, as Sophie's childcare responsibilities is one example of, this is about someone caring for you enough to stop you in your tracks and allowing you to recognize yourself as someone ill rather than someone who needs to be well. And clearly, it's not just about recognizing yourself. It's also about having the time and the space to do so. And the stratification of who has that time and space amidst inequality and precarity is important. So there are different roles here. There's a role for the healthcare practitioner in recognizing a person in need of care, a patient, and there is a role for the patient in accepting a moment when you need to be looked after. These are different roles. Accepting care means accepting difference. You will not be cared for as an equal with all difference flattened out. Someone else will have to care for you, them as the doctor or the nurse or the physiotherapist, etc., and you as the patient. But my argument is that patienthood is done better as a relative rather than an essential state. Sometimes you'll be positioned as a patient and you will need to be cared for by another. But this will not be all the time, and you may simultaneously be charged with caring for another, a child, a student, a friend in need, or even a patient if you yourself are a doctor or a nurse or another healthcare practitioner. Therefore, I avoid in this panel and in my research inviting patients to offer experiential accounts of how they feel about disease, following polls and keeping patient knowledge firmly in the realm of knowledge. I introduced a method in my interviews of trying to get at practice. I invited participants to take a photo of things they used to look after their bladder. Matt, if you can go to the next slide. Thanks. Recognizing patient knowledge around urinary symptoms in the practice of people who care for their bladders daily. Finding these practices desperately needed ways of caring outside of standard uses of antibiotics. This knowledge promises to become more important as antibiotics come under increasing pressure, but clinical care for urinary symptoms has become extremely orientated around antibiotics, even as antibiotics have never been able to offer care to everyone. So this isn't a moral argument against using antibiotics, but because antibiotics are so scalable, alternative and less scalable ways of caring are much more diverse. Patients living chronically with urinary symptoms told me about inventive and creative ways of living well, involving household objects and pharmaceuticals, including antibiotics. This is knowledge, not experience, and it stands in contrast to the defeated tone of guidance, which only recommends more antibiotics for people for whom antibiotics have not resolved symptoms. Patients with chronic conditions, like healthcare practitioners, are adept at doing care amidst huge infrastructural challenges of inequality, budget cuts, precarity, and some pretty unsafe living and working conditions. So here is a role for patients in practice. Can you go to the next slide, please, Matt? Thank you. The language of PPI, patient and public involvement, which I sometimes reference, has the significant advantage of being the language that other people use. And notably, these are people working beyond the critical mode, involving patients in medical research and making attempts to change what people do around antibiotics. So the language of PPI may be important in participating in what happens in practice, despite the criticisms I've made of it, of the way it tries to enroll people in describing how they feel about illness. And PPI can be done well. I've argued elsewhere that the PPI involvement on the ALTA trial can be seen as a model for collective mobilizations on AMR going forward. ALTA was a trial of methenamine hippurate as an alternative to prophylactic antibiotics for the treatment of recurrent urinary tract infections. It had been difficult to account for the benefits of non-antibiotic over antibiotic treatment in evidence review practices purely because antibiotic prophylaxis was more effective. But the ALTA trial design found a way to account for this because it was the PPI team which defined the non-inferiority margin as one episode of UTI per year per person. This was not uncontroversial and reflected a significant role for the PPI team in this trial. Noting that these patients with often quite extreme experiences of infection anticipate or already live a future without getting help from antibiotics, this patient involvement represented a collective mobilization on AMR, which too often is presented as interested in the group benefit as opposed to individual well-being. So in conclusion, we may need to reconsider current attempts to conceptualize patient participation in AMR policy and clinical research. I have argued that at the moment, the role offered to patients often seeks to enroll people into providing an experiential account of illness, seeing this as the only way to take account of the patient perspective. This poorly equips us for the task of doing care and of taking collective action on AMR, because it sets up impermeable boundaries between doctors, patients, those who are ill versus those who are well, those who speak about their patient experiences versus those who must listen, those people who can take reflective decisions about antibiotics versus those who can't. And I provided a few examples through the ALTA trial and approaching patients through practice of how we might mobilize collectively, taking account of different roles, but also noticing how we are all relationally invested in good care and good microbial futures. Thank you for listening. I'm really grateful for the opportunity to speak in such company and looking forward to all the other talks.